says, what's the best way to consume calories throughout the day? Let's say I consume 3,000 calories in a given day. Does it make a difference if I consume three meals of 1,000 calories each? He mentions three Popeyes chicken sandwiches and fries, right, Nate? Then he says also, versus consuming the 3,000 calories throughout the day with smaller meals and snacks. I guess this question pertains to all situations, off days, the time leading up to evening training, post-ride and pre-ride. So Paul, I think that what you'd like from this question is for us to tell you what to eat on Monday and how that's different than what you need to eat on Tuesday and so on throughout the week. And we're not going to do that. Instead, we're going to adhere more to principles. Is that correct, Amber?
Yeah. I think whenever you're asking the question is, you know, what's the best way to do this thing? It's important to step back and remember that there's a lot of different things that you could be optimizing for. So in this case, what are you optimizing for? Are you trying to figure out what's best for performance, for glycogen replenishment, for body composition, muscle protein synthesis, appetite, satiety, circadian rhythm, energy, mood, microbiome, inflammation, immunity? I mean, we could go on, right? So there's no one right answer to this where we can say, here's the prescriptive way, you know, things that you should eat at these times for what, you know, because what's best for you also is not necessarily going to be best for the person next to you. From a principle standpoint, one of the things I like to do is just to kind of apply some general principles that can be applied flexibly. So as an example, I always make sure that I have carbohydrate before, during, and after my training ride. And how much that is, it's flexible because it depends on what, you know, what I'm doing in my workout that day, how intense it is, how long I'm riding. If it's a really long ride, I'm always really good about eating at regular intervals during my ride. So if I'm doing a 4-hour ride, I'm going to end up eating more because I'm eating at those regular intervals during the ride. I'm always really good about having a recovery shake at the end of my workout. So I make sure that I've fueled for the performance that day, my workout, and then off the bike, I can say, okay, you know, I nailed my nutrition for my workout. So I fueled the performance and I've set myself up for optimal recovery. That box is checked. And then the rest of the day, I can focus on eating foods that are nutrient dense, that are really nourishing, because the rest of your day needs fuel too, right? Like, you need to show up with your full self for the people in your life. You need to show up with your full self for work, for career, for your family. And that takes energy. And the food that you eat is going to affect the energy that you bring to everything else you do in your life. It's going to affect your mood. So are you showing up with joy and enthusiasm for your family? Or are you feeling really broken down? I mean, so thinking about the types of foods that really genuinely nourish you in terms of sustainable energy, elevating mood. And that's a lot easier said than done. And I know that it can be the case that folks just end up in like a cycle of bad habits that can really kind of derail you in terms of tuning into what foods really, really work for you, tuning into when you really genuinely are hungry and it's a hunger signal versus reaching for something out of habit. And a really effective way of kind of calibrating this, if you will, is to use a food journal. And you can do this without counting calories, and you can just write down what you eat. And you can note to yourself, how did I feel while I was eating this? Was it enjoyable? Did it feel nourishing? Was it palatable? Did I feel satiated after I ate it? And then how long until you genuinely feel hungry again? Or, you know, when you next feel hungry, what are the circumstances surrounding that? Is it something that's kind of an external signal? Like, well, I just finished this shift and that's usually when I have this snack. And so my body was expecting this snack. So is it a habit or is it really hunger? And then, you know, you can start to identify some maybe emotional or environmental triggers and start teasing out what, you know, what's really a signal from your body versus what might be affecting you, you know, externally. And that kind of clarity is just unbelievably powerful, but it can take time depending on where you are.
Mm-hmm. This is another question too, where it kind of depends on if you're an average person or an athlete. And if you were to look into studies, this is the hard part. Chad just mentioned it with the study on artificial sweeteners and everything else. That's a very important asterisk to keep there. If you're listening to this podcast, chances are you're considered an athlete, like not a normal person, in the sense that you have a consistent output. You're doing work, you're following something that every day your body is in the habit of doing some sort of work. As a result, a lot of the time, the recommendations that we'll hear, it's like, it's better to eat a bunch of small meals, or it's better to do this. You always have to look at where that study is coming from in terms of who they're actually testing. What were the circumstances? What were they measuring for? Because it really depends. Since you're an athlete and you're going through this sort of thing, you really have to adhere to principles because this is so individual. And the cool part is, since you have an actual measurable output, in other words, what you're doing for work, that makes it so that principles are really easy to apply. If you don't have anything like that, then you're just kind of stuck. And if your life isn't demanding in any way of that, then it's really tough. So Amber, I just want to echo what you said one more time. It's so important. You got this question right here of of nutrient timing. When do I eat and what's the best time to eat? And it's all about driving performance and nutrients and making sure that what you're getting is sufficient for your life. We're not just talking about performance on the bike. We're talking about performance in general. And that's just such an important thing. So yeah, I guess just to share anecdote, my breakfast is usually something that is pretty normal. I'm usually somewhere around 500 to 600 calories for a breakfast. And then after that, when I train in the afternoon, my lunch is much more carb centric and it's larger. I train, I fuel throughout my workout. I have recovery nutrition right after. And then usually in the evenings, that's when I will have a smaller, or something that it's not a huge meal because I just simply don't need it before I go to bed. But it's really all about driving the performance. I have to eat that breakfast in the morning because I have to perform at work. And if I'm starving and I'm foggy brained, I'm not going to be performing at work. So I just really wanted applause, Amber, for taking that approach to answering this one. That was great. Do you have other points to share on here?
I want to defer to Ivy and Chad on this.
Cool.
Yeah, I'm on my own personal journey of trying to eat enough, which sounds silly, but like eating early enough and often enough throughout the day has been really challenging for me. Like, I feel like there's something wrong with my like brain to hunger signals where like, I don't get signals that I'm hungry, and basically realized that for a number of months, I was like borderline catabolic, eating less than 1,000 calories a day sometimes, like pretty often, because I just didn't know that I didn't feel like I was hungry and I was busy and I didn't know any better. Well, I knew better, but, so for Paul, you know, I would advise that, Amber's given some great framework on identifying what you need individually. But proper nutrition is a practice. Once you identify that stuff, it's not like you're just going to flip a light switch and be like, today's the day that I start eating more and better. Like, it's really hard. And it has to do with, you know, your tastes and like what you prefer. Like, it's going to be really difficult to work towards where you want to be nutritionally. And it's important to be like gentle with yourself and not, you know, beat yourself up. Like, it's easy for me to beat myself up when I forget to eat enough or, keep track of it and don't do enough. It's really important to understand that it's a super long process, and just the same as any physiological change that you make. And you might feel like, if you're like me and you have a hard time eating enough, like I feel like I'm forcing myself, like I make myself borderline sick sometimes, but it's super important. And now like it's easier for me to hit those calorie marks that I need, because I understood that it was a process and it's going to be rough at first. So be gentle with yourself, Paul.
Awesome. Chad, do you have anything to share on this one?
just briefly, I'll kind of tag along to what you guys have all pointed to, is that we're athletes and we're a different segment of the population. We have different demands, and that kind of handles itself to some extent. But as Ivy just pointed out, it's really hard to get detached from what our energy requirements are. And the term energy balance is pretty buzzy right now, but it describes what we're up against. I mean, we output a lot of energy. We have to replace that. It comes at some consequence somewhere. Maybe it doesn't affect performance right away, but it'll affect something. It's typically a negative effect. And that if you're not an athlete, man, there are no real rules. The most of the research supports that it doesn't matter what your eating pattern is, at least not for body composition and fat loss. And Amber linked to a study in here too, that says you can, and I chuckle every time I hear this term, but you can adopt a snake diet, right? Where you eat once a day. You get all those 3,000 calories in a single diet, and you just let your body kind of make use of it over the course of the rest of the day. You can eat 3,100 calorie meals. Neither of those things are really going to have a big impact on body comp and fat loss.
Right. But they might have a huge impact on your mood or
for sure, on a lot of other things
during the day. Yeah. Yeah. Sorry. Go ahead, Jonathan.
I was just going to say, I did that out of necessity when I was in Chile during my mission, because people were kind enough to feed us every once in a while, but we didn't have any money to pay for anything. So I wouldn't eat breakfast. They don't eat dinner in that country, really, at least where we were. So instead they just usually eat a big lunch. So I just ate I was a snake for 2 years, basically. I just ate a big old lunch and that was it. So you can learn to make do. Did I change that as soon as I was able to? 100%. So, but it is really important to stay in tune with your body. And like Ivy said, to kind of have a system of checks and balances, because you can lose perspective on it. Please, Amber, go ahead.
I just wanted to one follow-up thought. I think that a lot of what we read in terms of the science in just mainstream internet feeds relates a lot to people who lead sedentary lifestyles, who are at risk for heart disease and metabolic disorder, because these are genuinely very pervasive problems. And so these are the messages and the studies and the recommendations that we get inundated with on a daily basis. And it's important to remember it might not apply to you. And it's easy to forget that, because it's like osmosis. It's just constantly there. And it's hard to remind yourself that it's not necessarily you. And I think that a lot of people, as a result of that, just assume that they need to lose weight and that they need to cut calories. And fair enough, there are definitely people who do, absolutely. But like Ivy just pointed out, which I think is so important, is that there are people who are already under fueling who would do well to bring on more. And it's hard. That sounds so counterintuitive when you're swimming in this constant stream of messaging about diet more, exercise more, eat less. And it's not always going to be the thing that's going to make you feel better and perform better. So I just want to put that out there, because I think that that's a really, really common misconception. And you have to be really honest about where you are and what it is that's going to make you feel better. And that's where that food journal can potentially be a really helpful tool.
Just to reinforce that, tying back to what Chad just said, there's a big difference between average people and athletes. And what we see from our perspective is that athletes more often than not have the problem of underfueling, whereas the general population, that's not what we're focusing on. And we're not speaking to the general population. We're speaking to all of us here.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.
If you think I have better hair than Jonathan, give it a thumbs up. If not, leave a comment.
My hair is better than his.